Hey Curious Minds, we're headed out to explore the desert at night, and I'm joined by my friend Wyatt Mendez, who's an expert in all things creepy, crawly, and cool.
Miles, it's great to be out here. Looking forward to seeing what we find tonight.
Absolutely. I'm hoping for a productive evening, and I'm hoping to find some ants too. Let's get out there. Wow, that's wicked cool. So this is a bark scorpion, right? Now, how do you identify this is a bark scorpion?
Well, if we're not in a habitat that would imply the name bark scorpion at all. These guys are actually mostly lithophiles out in Arizona, which means that they love rocky habitats. This individual is basically being identified by the very long tail and then the very long, thin pinchers, basically.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've always heard that the really thin, kind of weak-looking pinchers is usually an indicator that they have a more potent venom. Does that tend to be true?
It does. The old kind of urban legend that people would talk about is actually fairly true.
If it comes to scorpions, the bigger the better.
Most of the time, species that have very large, robust claws don't really need much venom to take down their prey, and so those tend to have milder stings, while species with very thin, gracile claws tend to be the opposite. It's not always the case. We do have some species out here that have fairly thin claws, but aren't very venomous, such as Ceratodus. However, boothids tend to be fairly thin clawed, and boothids are not only our bark scorpions, uh-huh. but also some of the more famous death stalker scorpions and fat tail scorpions from Africa.
Yeah.
Wyatt is a trained and experienced professional. He has spent his entire life exploring the wilds of the Southwest. Please do not attempt to replicate his interactions with the wildlife in this video.
Now, this is a scorpion that I would never suggest anybody handle. Luckily, she's mellowed out a little bit since we initially spooked her. My belief when it comes to scorpions is, you know, if you don't know what you're messing with, always assume it's something that you don't want to be stung by.
So what sort of prey would this kind of a scorpion be going after?
I'd say just about anything that bumps into it out here. As you can see, we're in a very rocky habitat. However, there's a couple of old scrubby oaks that have held on out here. And these guys are found just as much in the rocks as they are in this slightly more mesic environment. And it's sometimes hard to kind of imagine what all is back there that they're entirely feeding on. There's definitely various beetle and carabid larvae that are back mm-hmm. there, all sorts of orthoptera, little crickets and stuff like that. Probably wood roaches and sand roaches and stuff living back in here too.
So Wyatt, a lot of people know that scorpions glow under UV light, but I gotta be honest, I have no idea why they do it. Do you know?
Really nobody knows for certain. There's a number of different kind of hypotheses out there. One of the theories that I think is most compelling is the idea that they're actually very, very sensitive to their own glowing. They have these eyes along the front of their carapace that are basically nestled right up next to the pinchers or the chelae when they're at rest. And the idea is that on very bright nights, when they would likely be predated on by owls or other such predators, they would not want to be out and moving about. And the UV light coming off of the moon might be enough for them to be able to sense, oh, I'm glowing, mm-hmm. I'm threatened. And this is supported by the fact that scorpions are very difficult to find on bright, moonlit nights. And if you are gonna find them in those situations, you almost always find them in shaded corners where they're hidden from the moon.
Super cool.
So we've got a colony of Acromyrmex versicolor. These are the native leaf-cutting ants here in Arizona. And I've actually never seen them out in this area of the desert, which is pretty awesome. So these guys aren't very active right now, but they've got a pretty nice defensive column right here, and they might be doing some excavating down below.
Looks like there's quite a bit of activity.
Oh, wow.
Along with the foraging column, extending outward.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, you can see the foraging column. They're all just kind of collectively moving out this way into the vegetation.
Although many people might think of tropical rainforests and grasslands when imagining leaf-cutting ants, new research indicates that they likely evolved in arid environments and then spread into more tropical biomes over millennia. These desert leafcutters are collecting dried flowers and other organic material, which they use to feed their subterranean fungus gardens. They spread across the desert in large foraging columns, and once a suitable food source is identified, they collect as much of it as they can and deposit the pieces near the nest entrance, ready for their sisters to take them down into the nest. Inside the colony, there may be multiple reproductive queens and many fungus chambers. Road cruising is an activity that allows biologists and wildlife enthusiasts to see snakes and other animals at night. During the day, the asphalt of the roads gets hot, and it retains some of that heat during the much cooler desert nights. Snakes are poikilotherms, which means that their body temperatures are largely determined by their environment. Staying warm allows them to be at their most active and alert, so they will stretch out on roadways to warm themselves at night. Unfortunately, this makes them vulnerable to car strikes and to poachers. Wyatt road cruises as both an opportunity to see local wildlife and to protect them by redirecting them off of the roadway.
What's really great about them is they're a little more docile during a closer interaction, so you can really appreciate the animal without being too concerned about it being aggressive towards you.
We just came across this wicked cool Mojave rattlesnake. Now the Mojave have the most toxic venom of the rattlesnakes that are out here, so we need to make sure we stay a good distance away. I'm also not wearing pants or any specific equipment for rattlesnake handling, so I won't be getting any closer than I am right now. All right, Wyatt, are you able to tell us about the two different types of venom that these snakes can have here in Arizona?
Well, depending upon the population, you have two things going on. You have primarily neurotoxic populations where the venom mostly targets the neurons inside your cells and causes your nervous system to shut down. And then you have hemotoxic populations. Those ones have venom that is much more specifically adapted to going after mammalian blood and causing it to basically turn into this horrible mixture you don't want inside of you. Out here in the Chiricahua Mountains, we have the neurotoxic, and that is considerably more dangerous. With the hemotoxic slash cytotoxic populations, there's a pretty good chance of getting to a hospital without too much of an issue. With these guys, especially with the remoteness of the Chiricahuas, you want to make sure to keep your distance and treat these animals with a lot of respect.
Unfortunately, Wyatt is not the only person looking for snakes out here. Unethical hobbyists travel to the area seeking to illegally collect snakes, either for their own personal collections or to sell on the black market. For that reason and others, this region is monitored by Arizona Game and Fish, and as we found out, the U.S. Border Patrol.
Immigration inspection guys, you guys are U.S. citizens. I'm guessing you guys are snake hunters.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, hold on the back windows real quick. All right, good luck. Oh!
Jesus. Oh, baggage.
What a wonderful.
Oh, wow.
So this might seem like kind of a weird spot for a rattlesnake to be hanging out, but this is actually a really well-established rodent trail that runs right through here. So she's just gonna sit there and wait for like a kangaroo rat or something like that to come by, and bam, grab it, inject it with venom, get that thing secure, and then she'll have her next meal. It's a really incredible ambush predator, and you can see just how easily they kind of blend in with the desert landscape. This looks just like a rock sitting here in the sand.
That's about as big as they get.
So this is Myrmecocystus mexicanus, and they are the largest of the nocturnal species. I believe there are two here. The other one would be Navajo. But what's awesome about mexicanus is that they form these crater mounds that go all around the nest entrance. And none of the other ants out here do that, so it's a really unique nest design. And of course they're living up to their name in terms of being nocturnal. We've got workers spread all across the desert here, and they're just going to be fanning out looking for dead insects. What's interesting about mexicanus is that they haven't been recorded bringing in lots of live prey. They seem to really be reliant on scavenging and then also getting honeydew from hemipterans that suck on plant sap.
Deep underground, the honeypot repletes are distended with the sugary liquids the colony has obtained from plants and sap-sucking insects. These food stores help to support the colony in times of drought or food unavailability. To help support the growing brood, some colonies may stockpile insect proteins and lipids in their repletes, but this is not commonly seen in captivity. Honeypot ants are fantastic symbols of the resiliency of animals that live in the desert, and of how so many organisms use unique strategies to survive in the most hostile environments on Earth.
I'm so excited to have found these honeypot ants. I was really, really hoping we'd come across a colony, and this is just a beautiful example of what they look like. What an awesome way to end our evening.